Hey guys, welcome back to this per unit tutorial. This is part 2 of tutorial 2. If you like this tutorial, please don't forget to give it a thumbs up and subscribe to my channel. You may also share it in your social media network. Thank you. So moving on from tutorial 1, we've calculated the per unit for the transformer and for the cable. Now we need to find out what's the per unit value of the load. Now the load is delta connected, so we must first convert it into a star configuration. That way it will be much easier for us to determine current flowing on each phase of the star configurations. Now before we do that, we first need to convert the load here, which is the z actual of the load, from the rectangular form into the polar form. I've already explained that using your calculator. It's much easier working on polar form values because it's going to make your calculation much easier. Now we can see that our load is actually delta connected. So how do we then do to convert it into a star connected load? So this is a delta connected load. There is a load here, there is a load there, there is a load there. But we need to convert it into a star connected load. This is much easier because we can see what's the current are flowing on each branch of the star configuration compared into the delta configuration. Now, how do we do that? But the formula is simple. For a balance load to convert from a delta to star, every branch of the star will be equal to each other, and they're going to be equal to the one branch of the delta divided by 3. Now we know that our z actual for each branch of the delta here is the 50 plus 20 J ohm, which is an inductive load, which could be maybe a motor, as we have illustrated here. Now that means on each side of that delta we have exactly the same motor that is connected, which result in the same impedance on each branch. So that's why it is called balanced. But in a situation where you have different motor, it could be all of them could be motors, but you have different one, maybe a big one, a small one, and a very big one, so they will have different impedance, so the load will be unbalanced. Or you could maybe have a house on one side, on one face, two motors on the other two phases, so the load will also be unbalanced. Okay, so now in this case we have a balanced load. The formula for unbalanced is very different. We will look at in the previous in the future tutorial. So now this is a formula, then we can replace the values. Now we have our value, that is 53.85 with an angle of 20.8 divided by 3. This gives us a 18.20.8 degree angle of a z actual for each of these star connected phase. So each of these star point now they have an actual impedance of 18 ohm with an angle of 20.8 degree. Now moving on, since now we got the Z actual, the next thing to do is to calculate the Z per unit. Now the formula for Z per unit is the Z actual divided by the Z base. Now Z base must be calculated using SB of the load. But because SB of the load is not given, SB of the load is, if you look at the motor nameplate, they will give you what is the rated apparent power. But it's not given here, so we're going to use the rated SB for this entire network. That means the SB new for the entire network. Now VB zone is equal to VB rated of the load. So I mean, imagine if you have a motor that is only working for 230 volt AC. Now that means your transformer here must supply 230. It cannot supply more than that because the motor windings are going to explode. It's going to get too hot. Okay, so now the VB zone must be what's rated for that load. That is very important to know, but because they didn't tell us what's the rated value here, we now need to calculate what's the VB zone. Using the formulas as we have seen on tutorial 1, there is a way to calculate VB zone. If you haven't watched tutorial 1 yet, please click the link on your screen so that you can catch up. Okay, now moving on, we can then replace all the values. Replacing all the values, as I've said, for those who have watched tutorial 1, they know how we got this value of 242.67. That is our VB zone. And we square it as for the formula. And this is SB new. That is our S base. Now we found a value of 2.944 ohm. That is the value for the base impedance of the load. Now you can see that we got everything. We got the Z actual for each branch of the star, and now we also have the Z base of the load. Then we can then go ahead and calculate the Z per unit of the load for each star connected configuration. Now this will mean it's going to be 18 with an angle of 20.8 degrees, as we found here, divided by 2.944. This gives us a value of 6.114 with an angle of 20.8 degrees. Now this is still in polar form. We have to convert it into a rectangular form. The important things about rectangular form here, it's illustrate. We can see how much is a resistive and how much is inductive inside our load. Just a quick note. So if the load is a motor here, now we know the motor got windings, okay? So inside the coil there, the coil got its own resistance and the inductance. So this is what this illustration is important. Okay, now we have calculated everything. We've got the per unit of the transformer one, of the cable, and of the load. Now we can now go ahead and draw our per unit diagram. Now the per unit diagram is as follow. Again, watch tutorial 1 so you can get yourself up to date. Now this is for the transformer, this is for line, and this one here is for the load. Now if you watch tutorial 1 again, they've asked us to find the high voltage and low voltage current. Now this is a transformer, this one is a transformer, so this is a high voltage side and this is a voltage side, the low voltage side, because this is a step down transformer. So we need to find the current that's flowing on the high voltage side, and we need to find the current that's flowing on the low voltage side. Remember, it's a series circuit, but because there is a transformer, so the current found here is not going to be the same current. So this is a primary current, this is a secondary current that's flowing here. Okay, but before we do that, we need to find first the I per unit of the entire system. But how do we determine the I per unit of the entire system? There is a formula for that. I per unit is equal to 1 divided by Z per unit total. Okay, 1 divided by Z per unit total. Why 1? 1 is actually the V per unit. That is this one here, the V per unit. Remember, this is a per unit system we're working on, so it's normally supposed to be I per unit is equal to V per unit divided by Z per unit. But because in a balanced normal system, the V per unit is always equal to 1, so we only put 1 in there to make it easier to understand. Now moving on, we need to calculate the total per unit. You can see the total per unit need to be calculated in order for us to find I per unit. That means we just add everything. So we need to add the real part and the imaginary part together, and we find a Z per unit total of 5.845 plus 2.433 J. Now moving on, we can then go ahead and calculate I per unit. So I per unit will be 1 over Z per unit total, and we found this. And if we convert it into a rectangular form, because this is polar, then we found this value for I per unit. So I per unit is equal to 0.160 amp per unit. Now we can go ahead and calculate the line current for the high voltage side and the low voltage side. Now for the high voltage side, we know that is before the transformer, just after the generator, that is this current right here. Now that current is equal to I per unit times IP. Now remember, I per unit is what's flowing here. So there is I per unit flowing there. Forgive my writing here. So that's I per unit that is flowing that side. So which means this current here is equal to the I per unit times the I base. But where is the I base? I base is not I per unit. I base is the current that is flowing out of the generator. The maximum current that the generator is supplying, that is the I base. So our line current for the high voltage side is then given like that. So now we need to find I base, and we know that I base is, since it's flowing out of the generator, so that is SB nu, the base apparent power that we're working on, divided by the square root of 3 times VB. What is VB? VB is the voltage of the generator. Again, look for tutorial 1 and you'll see what we did to get those values as they were given. Now we're replacing everything. So SB is 20 to the power 3. VB, that is 2.6 kilovolt with a square root of 3. So that's the I base current. But now we need to find the line current that is flowing from the generator, which must be multiplied with the I per unit. That is equal to 0.16 times 4.44, and that gives us a current of 0.71 amp. Moving on, we need now to determine the line current for the low voltage side. The low voltage side is the side of the step down. So that is going to be different. How? Because the voltage is now loaded. But the formula remains the same. That is I per unit times IB. The interesting part here is that IB is no longer going to be exactly the same as this IB here. Why? Because the voltage used to calculate this IB was a high voltage. Now the voltage used now to calculate this IB here is going to be a low voltage, because it's now a step down side. Now again, that voltage is the 242.67. So that is the voltage on that zone after the transformer. If you look at tutorial part 1, you will see how we found that. 20 times 10 to the power 3, that is the SB base that we are working on, SB nu. So now this gives us a current of 47.58 amp. Now this is I base that is flowing out of the transformer. Now we need now to calculate the line current now with our per unit. Now that's going to be equal to 0.16 times 47.58. That gives us a line current of 7.61 amp. Now you can see everything's lines up well. For a high voltage side, the current is very low. For a low voltage side, the current is high. This is why it makes sense, because electricity is transmitted on a high voltage, low current. Because low current means there will be less losses, there will be less heat generated, so you're not going to have a lot of heat dissipation and power losses. Okay, so when electricity reaches destination, then it needs to be stepped down from the high voltage. Now when they step it down, the current goes up. Why does the current goes up? Because you step down the voltage, the current must go up so that you maintain. So you maintain caveat in, caveat out. The rating of the transformer must be maintained. So that is how you find the current on the high voltage side and the low voltage side of the transformer in a per unit system calculation. Thank you for watching. If you have enjoyed this tutorial, please don't forget to give the thumbs up and subscribe to my channel.